Blackstone Publishing presents Highway 61 by David Housewright. This book is read by Brent Hinkley. For Renee, again and forever. I wish to acknowledge my debt to India Cooper, Keith Kala, Alison J. Picard, and Renee Valois. 1. I watched Erica through my kitchen window while she tossed breadcrumbs to the ducks that lived beside the pond in my backyard, and I wondered, when did she become so damn pretty? She was cute when I first met her, but that was when she was nearly 15. Now she was 12 days past her 18th birthday and nearly as beautiful as her mother. Certainly she was taller by at least 2 inches. Erica confided to me once that when she was sure her mother was going to scold her over some offense, she would put on high heels so she would tower over her. "I keep hoping it'll intimidate her," she said, "only it never does." The man sitting at the table behind me sighed dramatically. I ignored him. He pulled a pack of Marlboros from his jacket pocket, shook one out, and placed it between his lips. I waited until he lit it with a silver lighter. "No smoking," I said. Jason Truhler sighed again, putting more effort into it this time. He moved to the sink, drowned the cigarette with the faucet, and dropped the remains into the garbage disposal. I continued to watch his daughter while he slipped silently back into the chair. Erica knelt on the grass and scattered breadcrumbs so close to her that the ducks came near enough to pet. I almost opened the window and shouted, "They bite, you know." I didn't, because I knew she wouldn't like it. The ducks had moved in soon after my father and I had built the pond a few years back. Dad liked the ducks. One of the things he told me just before he died was to take care of them. So I did, feeding them corn and grain and whatever they put in those bags of wild bird seed I buy at Petco. Ever since, they would leave in the fall and return in the spring, often more than a dozen birds at a time. I used to name them until it became impossible for me to tell them apart. I glanced at my watch. It told me the day, month, and date. Sunday, November 8. Duck hunting season had been open for nearly a month, and while the ducks were safe within the Twin Cities metropolitan area, I was always worried about how they would fare once they started south. I expected them to take wing at any moment, was surprised that they hadn't left long ago. A pal at the DNR said they might have lingered past their traditional departure date because I fed them, because I domesticated them. I hoped not. Truhler sighed again. "What exactly do you want from me?" I asked. I continued to look out the window. "Ricky says you help people." "Favors," I said. Since quitting the St. Paul cops to take a $3 million reward for capturing a particularly resourceful embezzler, I have, on occasion, assisted people with their more pressing issues. I sometimes do favors for friends, people I like. I don't like you. You don't know me. I know your ex-wife. Not everything Nina says about me is true. Of course it is. You haven't heard my side. I turn my head just enough to look him in the eye. I don't want to hear your side. But what? There's nothing to debate here. I love your ex-wife. I love her enough to say so to complete strangers. Which means I'm more than happy to dislike her ex-husband with as much vehemence as she desires for whatever reason she deigns to offer. Any questions? I knew it was a mistake coming here, Truhler said. I returned to the window. Marvelous Margot, the woman with whom I shared the pond, emerged from her house and walked across her lawn. Erica saw her. They screamed each other's name the way teenagers do that have been apart for a while and hugged, although Margot was hardly a teenager. She was pushing 45. She had been pushing 45 for as long as I'd known her. Margot was a life-loving babe. I could think of no better way to describe her. She was a babe not only in her wolf-whistle appearance, but also in her take-no-prisoners attitude. One of those free spirits who lived exactly as she wished, as her three ex-husbands could attest. As far as I knew, she and Erica had spoken less than a half dozen times, yet Erica seemed to like her enormously. I wasn't sure if that was a good thing or not. "I wouldn't have come here at all," Truhler said, "except Ricky said you could help me. She said you could be trusted. I'd hate to see her disappointed." Meaning I would be the one who disappointed her, not him. "Does Erica know what trouble you're in?" I asked. "She knows. She only knows I'm having difficulty and that it has something to do with a trip I took in July. I admitted that much to her when she came to visit this weekend. I get her every third."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.